Yo, what's up, guys? It's Noah here, and in today's video, I'm going to be taking a first look at the NBA slate on DraftKings for Friday, October the 28th. We do have a big Friday night slate, 11 games tonight, guys, so we're going to go game by game and kind of give my quick thoughts, what stands out to me taking a first look at the slate from each game, taking a first look on Thursday night. But before we do get started with the breakdown, as always, if you guys do enjoy these DFS videos, make sure you hit that like button down below, hit that subscribe button if you have not yet. And check out the sponsor of the video, Prize Picks. Prize Picks, they are a player prop based DFS site. Very simple, very easy to use. You're just taking the over or the under. You're taking more or less on a player's projection. Obviously, you know, since it's a big slate, there's going to be a ton of props available that you can choose from tonight. Right now, there's not much available. They only have props up for the Cavs and Celtics game. But, you know, once we get closer to the start of the games on Friday, there will be a ton of props available. Take a look at their board, see if there's anything that stands out to you that you want to take. On Prize Picks, you have to make at least 2 picks, but you can make up to 5 picks. You can mix and match sports, and you can win up to 10 extra money on Prize Picks. It's a lot of fun. You guys definitely need to be playing over there. Make sure that when you sign up, use promo code NOAH, so that way you do get a deposit bonus when you sign up. As always, guys, I will be sharing a couple plays I like for Prize Picks today. Probably will upload that video. I'll have a separate Prize Picks video going up on the channel probably sometime on Friday, you know, early Friday morning. Just because right now there's not really much on the board and it's going to be tough to make a video with, you know, with these being the only props available. So check the channel sometime on Friday. Should have a Prize Picks video up talking through some props I like for this Friday night slate. But yeah, guys, let's talk through it. 11 games. We'll start off with the Charlotte and Orlando game. So looking at this game, there is definitely some appealing plays here. You know, Orlando, I think it's a pretty good matchup for them. Charlotte last season was a pretty fast-paced team, didn't play much defense. I think it's, you know, kind of going to be the same this season. You know, when you're looking at price tags in this game, there's not a ton of guys that stand out as like glaring values or like, you know, guys that are way too cheap. But I think there's definitely some guys here that have some upside. I think it's a good matchup for Paolo Banchero. He's shown some big upside this season. The $7,800 price tag doesn't make him a standout play today, but I definitely think he's viable in tournaments. Same could be said for Wendell Carter Jr. Really good matchup for him. We've seen bigs have a lot of success against Charlotte. You know, they had a lot of success against them last season. I think it'll kind of be the same this season. And then you got all these guys on the Charlotte side that are benefiting right now with LaMelo Ball out and Terry Rozier doubtful. So no Terry Rozier, no LaMelo Ball. Should mean a lot of opportunity for Gordon Hayward, Dennis Smith Jr., and Kelly Oubre. Yeah, where these guys are priced at, I don't think any of them are like must plays today, but I think they're still viable. You know, Gordon Hayward, I think, does have a bigger ceiling without LaMelo and Rozier. He's going to have the ball in his hands more, going to get more usage. He's a guy that can do a little bit of everything when he's on the floor. I still do have some interest in Gordon Hayward today. Dennis Smith Jr., I played him last slate when he was 6K. I thought 6K was still like a price tag that he could outperform, and you know, he had a pretty good game, 39 DraftKings points, played 37 minutes. That game did go to overtime, but at 6,300 here, like, I think Dennis Smith Jr. is still in play. He's been really productive. He's been about a fantasy point per minute player this year with the Hornets. He should get, you know, probably mid-30s minutes without LaMelo and Rozier. So I definitely still like Dennis Smith Jr., probably my favorite play on Charlotte. And then Kelly Oubre, I think, is fine as well. He's going to get more usage. Was a little bit disappointing last game, but he also shot the ball pretty poorly. Should get big minutes here. Solid matchup. I think Oubre at 6,200 is firmly in play as well. PJ Washington at his price tag doesn't really stand out. Not a guy that I'm super in love with today. Do want to talk about the Orlando backcourt. So Cole Anthony is going to be out for this game, and we know Jalen Suggs is still out as well. So I'm guessing that RJ Hampton is going to start at point guard. Now, DraftKings, surprisingly, they actually priced up RJ Hampton to 5,200. So I'm actually glad they did this because I did not want to play RJ Hampton. If RJ Hampton was like 3,500, I think he'd be like massive chalk today. But since he's 5,200, I don't expect him to get much ownership. He's going to be starting at point guard and he'll probably play like 25 to 30 minutes. So he's not like out of play today. But I'm, you know, at 5,200, I'm not really running to roster RJ Hampton. Expecting him to start though. And he's, you know, he's a playable option, but. From Charlotte, I think definitely like my favorite plays are Hayward, Smith, or Dennis Smith Jr. and you know Kelly Oubre. I will say that I think no Cole Anthony is a boost for Franz Wagner. We could definitely see Franz Wagner handle the ball more. 6,400 price tag feels about right for him, but you know he is definitely you know viable as well. But in general, I think my favorite play from this game is probably Dennis Smith Jr. He's the guy that I kind of have the most interest in on this one. Let's move on to the next game. Talk about Atlanta and Detroit. Just saw these teams play a couple days ago. Trae Young had a really big game against Detroit. Went for, you know, 50 DK points. He got off to a really, really hot start. He kind of cooled off in the second half, but still went for 35 points, 6 assists, 3 rebounds, played 38 minutes. You know, Trae's been taking a ton of shots, 20-plus shot attempts in 4 straight games. Usage has been really, really high. even playing with DeJounte Murray, that has not stopped Trey from producing at a really high rate. So I think Trey's more of a GPP play today, but he is still viable. Same could be said for DeJounte Murray. I would probably prefer Trey over Murray, but DeJounte Murray, we know, is a guy that can do everything when he's on the floor. Score, rebound, get assists, can get defensive stats. He's fine, but not like a standout play today. And then like the Detroit side, I mean, there's not a ton that I'm loving on Detroit today. I think all these guys are kind of priced appropriately. Jaden Ivey is questionable. He was kind of a late scratch last game. We did see Corey Joseph start in place of Jaden Ivey. I'm guessing Corey Joseph will start again. He got into some early foul trouble, but still wound up playing 32 minutes. Now, Corey Joseph has never been a great point per minute player, but like if you want to go there for value, I don't think it's terrible. Like I think he's playable, especially if he gets 30 plus minutes, but I have a feeling that we're going to have better value available today, because there's some questionable guys that we'll talk about later that could definitely, you know, if they get ruled out, could open up a lot of value. But if Corey Joseph does start again, he will be in play. Obviously, that's assuming, you know, Jaden Ivey's out. If Jaden Ivey is out, you know, slight boost for guys like Cade Cunningham, Bojan, Sadiq Bey, but none of them really stand out at their price tags. You know, John Collins has been playing really well this season, but he's also 7K now. So, like, at 7K, I'm not super excited about John Collins. I still think he's viable, but he feels priced appropriately. Clint Capella just hasn't been getting enough minutes. He's pretty cheap at 5,600, but he's only playing like 25 minutes a night right now, so tough to really want to go there. Like, I think that's it from this game. There's not a ton that I'm loving here. I think my favorite play is probably Trae Young, but I think he's just kind of, you know, Trae Young's just more of a contrarian spend-up option here. No standout plays coming from Atlanta, Detroit. So moving on to the next game, Cleveland and Boston. You know, another one that I'm not like really that excited about. You know, two pretty good defensive teams, two slow-paced teams as well. Jason Tatum is always someone you can pay up for, but it's a tougher matchup, and I just don't think Tatum stands out as a priority spend up today. I think there's other guys I'd rather spend for. We have Giannis on the slate. We have Jokic on the slate. We have LeBron as well, AD. So not really going to go out of my way to play Tatum, but he's always viable. Same could be said for Donovan Mitchell. We've seen Donovan Mitchell play really well without Darius Garland lately. Finally had a disappointing game last game, but he's an okay pay-up option, but it is a really tough matchup. Definitely, you know, not super excited about Mitchell here. Jaylen Brown is just like, he's there. Like, he's just not a standout play. You know, Jared Allen's been playing really, really well lately. Been producing, you know, at a much better rate. Over 40 DraftKings points in back-to-back games. I think Jared Allen might be my favorite play from this game if I had to play anyone. We know Jared Allen is, you know, pretty likely to get a double-double. He's a guy that can block shots as well. I think the way you beat Boston, like if you're going to beat Boston, it's probably down low with bigs. Like, I don't think Al Horford's like the elite defensive big man that he used to be. So I think Jared Allen at 7,400 is like an okay option. Caris LeVert, you know, should continue to benefit without Garland, but he's 6,200 now. So not really excited about LeVert. Evan Mobley looks solid last game. They've been saying they want to get him more involved. He's kind of been off to a slow start this season. 6,100 though, just feels like an appropriate price tag for Mobley. Like, he's playable. That's really it, though. Like, there's nothing that I'm loving in this game. You know, it should be a fun game to watch. Should be a close one. But I just don't see a ton of DFS plays that I'm really going to be targeting here. So let's move on to the next one. Philly and Toronto. You know, another game, man, that I'm just not that excited about. These are two, you know, good defensive teams. These are also two of the slowest-paced teams in the league. I think the Sixers are actually dead last in pace this season. And the Raptors are, like, bottom five as well. So hard to get excited about a ton of guys here. Embiid is just like a contrarian spend-up option. We did see these teams just play a couple days ago. Embiid wasn't great. 41 DraftKings points in 38 minutes. He did score a lot, but he really didn't get many rebounds or assists. You know, Toronto's defensively a good team, and they're also a team that has historically kind of limited Embiid. So not that excited about Embiid. Same for Harden. Harden's been great this season, but I think he's priced appropriately, especially for this kind of, you know, tough matchup. Also, he did struggle a little bit when these teams just played recently. Not in love with Harden today. The, you know, the Toronto guys, Siakam, Van Vliet, Scotty Barnes, Gary Trent, none of them really stand out to me. Siakam, if I had to play anyone on Toronto, he would probably be my favorite guy just because he's been so good this season. Super, super consistent, giving you a really high floor. We know that massive ceiling is there as well. Now, I will say that, you know, the one positive about this game is that both these teams are going to run very tight rotations. Both these teams don't have a ton of bench depth, so you can expect massive minutes for Embiid, Harden, Siakam, Van Vliet, most likely Scotty Barnes, Maxey, Trent. Like, you know these guys are getting big minutes. That's the one positive. The downside is that, you know, it's just a slow pace, gross game. I don't think you're going to see a ton of points scored in this one. But that's not saying that you can't play anyone in this game. I just don't know if there's any standout plays for me. You know, not a ton I'm loving here. If I had to play anyone from this game, probably would be like Pascal Siakam. But yeah, not a ton I'm loving. I do believe that Tyrese Maxey had a really big game against Toronto. Yeah, he did. 52 DraftKings points in 43 minutes. You know, Toronto is a team that does trap a lot. They, you know, anytime a guy like Embiid or Harden touches the ball, they're going to see a lot of double teams. And I think that's what led to Maxey having a really big game. I didn't get to watch that game, but I'm guessing that could have been the reason Maxey did so well. But like 6,200, you know, Maxey just, he's like an okay play. But, you know, Maxey played 43 minutes in regulation. He's getting a ton of run right now. That's, you know, obviously a positive. Let's go ahead and move on to the next game, though. Talk about Indiana and Washington. So, you know, you got two decent, you know, two decently fast-paced teams, I do believe. I think the Pacers are towards the top of the league in pace. Don't know about the Wizards. They might be more towards the bottom. Actually, I have the pace stats on my other monitor right now. So this season, Washington 25th in pace, and the Pacers are 6th. So, yeah, Washington has been kind of slow, but Indiana has been a fast-paced team. You know, I think it's a pretty good matchup for these Washington guys, Beal, Porzingis, Kuzma. But again, like 8,600 for Beal, he's not really been performing that well this season. He's yet to have over, you know, 41 DraftKings points. He's just a contrarian spend-up option at the most. Like, I just don't really have a ton of interest in Beal right now. Porzingis, I think, should do really well in this matchup. You know, Miles Turner is back, which I guess hurts a little bit, but I still think it's a good spot for Porzingis. It's 7,900, though. He's not someone that I'm really prioritizing building around. Same goes for Kuzma. Halliburton, we know, has a massive upside. If this game stays close, Halliburton's probably going to be the reason why. He should play big minutes here. But again, like at 8,300, I think Halliburton is kind of priced appropriately. If I had to play anyone in this game, it probably would be Halliburton, either Halliburton or Porzingis. I don't really see much value from this one. I know Will Barton's been getting some more minutes lately. He played 29 minutes last game, 35 the game before that. I think, you know, I'm pretty sure Bradley Beal went to the locker room last game, and that might have been the reason that Will Barton played so much. So, like, I wouldn't be going to roster Will Barton today. I wouldn't be, like, super excited about him. But his minutes have been trending up, at least, which I guess is a positive. But, yeah, man, like, there's just not a ton to love in this game either. A lot of unappealing games on this slate, even though we have, you know, 11 of them. There's definitely some games I just don't really have a ton of plays I'm loving from. So, let's go ahead and move on to the next game, talk about the Knicks and the Bucks. So, we got Giannis at the top here. I think Giannis, probably the best spin-up option on the slate. Like, him and Luka have just been on another level this season when it comes to fantasy point production. 58, 64, 74 DraftKings points from Giannis. I mean, even in a blowout against Houston, he still put up 64 DK points. Like, he's just crushing right now. He's playing at a really high level. The fantasy points per minute have been through the roof. His usage rate is through the roof as well. I think Giannis is a top play today. I mean, it's going to depend on what kind of value we get. He's really expensive at 12,100, but I definitely want to be playing Giannis if I can. Pretty much any slate Giannis is on, he's going to stand out as a top play. Jrue Holiday at 8,100 is just like okay. I'm not that interested in Jrue today. Julius Randle at 7,900 does feel a little bit too cheap, but you know, he's not really been playing that well this season. He's kind of been inconsistent. He's had two big games. He's also had two pretty disappointing games. We've seen Jalen Brunson take on a really big role with the Knicks, and you know, I think that's what a lot of people expected. Brunson was incredible last game, had 60 DraftKings points, nearly had a triple-double. Like, I think he's probably my second favorite play in this game behind Giannis. I mean, Brunson is just getting a ton of minutes right now. His usage rate's been really good. He's stuffing the stat sheet, doing everything. The price tag is definitely up there now. Like, 7,300 is a lot for Brunson. I think that will keep his ownership low, though, so if you want to play like Giannis and then run it back with Brunson as kind of like a little mini stack, I mean, I don't really ever stack an NBA, but I could definitely see doing that, especially if this game does stay close. Hopefully it does. If it does, you could definitely see Giannis and Brunson both do really well. But like RJ Barrett, he's just like okay, doesn't really stand out at 6,500. I know Bobby Portis had a big game last game. He'll probably get like mid-20s minutes off the bench, but I wouldn't expect him to put up, you know, 45 DraftKings points in 26 minutes again. Most nights he's putting up like, you know, 25, 30 DK points. But it is a revenge game against one of his former teams. So like Portis is okay, I guess. There's nothing else though that really stands out. I definitely think the best play in this game is, you know, obviously Giannis. And I do have some interest in Julius Randle Jalen Brunson as a tournament play. Julius Randle's fine too, but I definitely like Brunson the most from the Knicks side. Let's go ahead and move on to the next game though. Talk about the Lakers and the Timberwolves. So, man, the Lakers, I mean, they've not looked great this season. 0-4 to start the season. Russell Westbrook, once again, might miss this game. He's listed as questionable, so this will be something to monitor. I don't think Westbrook being out, like, has a major impact, but obviously just would mean, you know, even bigger roles for LeBron and AD. Right now, LeBron and AD are just dominating the usage. They're taking all the shots. You know, LeBron's handling the ball a ton. At 10,300, I think LeBron's like one of the safest spend-ups. I mean, he had his worst game of the season last game against Denver, and he still put up 40 DraftKings points. Like, his floor is just so high, and we know LeBron has a big ceiling as well. This should be a very fast-paced game. Right now, you know, looking at pace this season, Timberwolves playing at the fifth fastest pace in the league, and the Lakers are playing at the second fastest pace in the league. So this should be a very fast-paced, high-scoring game. LeBron should thrive in this matchup. I don't think Minnesota really has anyone to stop LeBron, so I definitely think LeBron's a good pay-up option. I think Anthony Davis is viable, too. Don't love the matchup with him going up against Gobert, but AD's just had a massive role this season. His usage rate's been, you know, sky high. He's been grabbing a ton of boards, starting at center, been playing really big minutes. I'll be interested to see if the Lakers do change up their starting lineup going up against Towns and Gobert. They might start, like, Damian Jones or something. Because, when you look at their starting lineup, it's going to be LeBron, AD, Lonnie Walker, Patrick Beverley, and then obviously Westbrook. If he plays, if he doesn't play, it'll probably be Austin Reeves. They might start another big today, or maybe LeBron will guard Karl-Anthony Towns or something. I don't know, but definitely keep an eye on the Lakers' starting lineup. Could change that, or they could make a change, you know, because of this matchup. But yeah, LeBron and AD, I think, are both firmly in play today. On the Minnesota side, I don't know if there's any standout plays coming from Minnesota, but it is a really good matchup here. So I feel like one of these Minnesota guys is probably going to do well. Towns is 8,800. Gobert's 8,500. You know, so far this season, we've seen Towns have a couple big games. We've seen Gobert have a couple big games. These guys seem to, like, negatively correlate. It seems like whenever Gobert does poorly, Towns does well, and then vice versa. So I don't know if I'd play those two guys together, but, like, I think one of them probably does well here. The matchup is really good, man. Same with, like, Anthony Edwards and D'Angelo Russell. Like, I'm not going to play multiple Timberwolves today, but I think playing one of the main four guys is totally fine. Just because, yeah, the Lakers are not a good defensive team. They do play really fast. I think this game will be high scoring. If you're playing LeBron, like, or Anthony Davis, I think it does make sense to maybe play someone on the Minnesota side. Just hope that the game stays close and, you know, that it winds up being high scoring. Anthony Edwards, we know, has a massive ceiling, can get hot anytime. Had a huge game last game against San Antonio. 56 DK points, you know, 34 points, 3 rebounds, 9 assists. I think Anthony Edwards is okay. D'Angelo Russell, I don't hate either. A little revenge game for him. Probably my least favorite play, though, from Minnesota. I think of all the main Minnesota guys, Anthony Edwards is probably my favorite, but, you know, that's not really, like, a strong take. And then, like, some value in this game. I mean, there's not really much value to go to. Lonnie Walker continues to start and play around 30 minutes a night. He's, like, at 5,300, he's okay. You know, this should be a fast-paced game, so, like, I could see him doing well here, but 5,300 doesn't make him, like, a standout play. Same goes for Patrick Beverley. I think Beverley will get a little bit of a boost if Westbrook's out, but 5K. Don't really like Beverley that much at 5K. Kendrick Nunn came off the bench, played about 20 minutes last game. I'd assume if Westbrook's out, we probably get similar run for Nunn again. Not really going to go there on a big slate like this. And then Austin Reeves, he did start in place of Westbrook last game. Again, I think the Lakers could change up their starting lineup today because of the matchup. If Reeves starts again, like, I'm probably not going there. He doesn't offer enough upside. So really, you know, the interest in this game is all, it's on the stars. LeBron, AD, and then, you know, the big four for Minnesota. This is where I'm really looking to. I don't think there's anyone else I'm going to be playing in this game besides, you know, those guys or even, you know, interested in. So let's go ahead and move on to the next one, Chicago and San Antonio. So looking at the Bulls today, definitely need to talk about them because Zach LaVine is currently questionable. This will be something to monitor. Obviously, if LaVine plays, you know, it kind of be the same thing we say all the time with the Chicago guys. I mean, when they're all healthy, it's tough to predict which one to go to, if any of them. I don't think any of them would stand out as, like, top plays today. You know, obviously, revenge game for DeRozan, if you want to factor that in. But if LaVine gets ruled out, then definitely, you know, big boost for DeRozan, big boost for Vooch as well. I think both these guys will be viable if LaVine is out. DeRozan might be my favorite between the two, especially with him and Vooch closely priced. But, you know, San Antonio this season been playing at the third fastest pace in the league. So I think it's a pretty good matchup. Should be a pretty fast-paced game. So, yeah, my interest on the Chicago side is going to depend on if Zach LaVine plays, I think. And then some of these San Antonio guys. So, once again, Devin Vassell is going to be out for San Antonio. Josh Primo is going to be out as well. You should see big usage for Keldon Johnson. He's 7,200, though. So, like, I don't think he really stands out as a top play today. Jakob Poeltl's price tag starting to come up there. He's definitely been underpriced the last few slates, but I think 6,800 is now, like, an appropriate price tag for Poeltl, so I'm not in love with him. Trey Jones at 6K, again, probably going to have a big role, especially without Vassell and without Primo. Should play pretty good minutes, but he's 6K now. Like, finally DraftKings priced up these Spurs guys. I feel like I've been playing the Spurs, like, every slate. Don't know if I'll be going to many of them today. You know, the one guy that does kind of look interesting is Josh Richardson. Josh Richardson obviously was like massive chalk last slate after Primo got ruled out and after after Vassell got ruled out too. With those guys out again, we should see Josh Richardson start, should play probably low to mid 30s minutes. Do I expect Josh Richardson to put up a double-double and put up 38 DraftKings points? Like, I think that's pretty unlikely to happen again, but he's 5,400. The price tag obviously came up. I don't think Richardson really stands out as like a top play today, but he's at least still viable. You know, Richardson has been relatively productive on a point-per-minute basis this season with the Spurs. Should play low 30s minutes. He's probably my favorite play from San Antonio. And obviously, again, you know, my interest on Chicago is going to depend on if Zach LaVine plays or not. If LaVine plays, not much I love. If LaVine's out, I think DeRozan and Vooch are both viable. You could maybe look to the guards as well, like Ayo or Caruso, but they wouldn't be like super appealing on a big slate like this. So let's go ahead and move on to the next game, Utah and Denver. So looking at Jokic here at 11K, you know, historically, when we think about Utah, we think tough matchup, but it's a great spot for Jokic. Obviously, Jokic or Utah no longer has Rudy Gobert, so it's going to be like Kelly Olynyk and, I mean, Walker Kessler will probably get some minutes. He'll probably try and guard Jokic. Jokic should crush here. Now, these teams have already played this season, and Denver got blown out by Utah. Jokic only put up 46 DK points in 33 minutes. I'd expect a much better performance from Jokic today. I don't think Utah really has anyone to slow down Jokic. Right now, when you're looking at pay-up options on this slate, I think I do lean Giannis over Jokic, but no issue going to Jokic today. He's clearly one of the better spins. Lauri Markkanen's been amazing for the Jazz this season, but the price tag at 7,100 now doesn't make him a standout play. I think he's still viable, but like he's not someone that I'm going to be forcing into my lineups. Same goes for Clarkson and Conley. They're both just priced appropriately. Jamal Murray is still kind of on a minutes limit, so even though he's only 6,100, he's not really someone I'm looking to. Tough spot for Kelly Olynyk. I think Kelly Olynyk could get into some foul trouble here. He was in foul trouble last time these teams played. Got 5 fouls in 15 minutes, so really tough to go to Kelly Olynyk, plus the price tag's up to 6K now. Michael Porter Jr. is questionable, so keep an eye on this. If Michael Porter Jr. does sit, that would just obviously benefit Jokic even more. Probably benefit Aaron Gordon as well. And you would see Bruce Brown start most likely. Now, Bruce Brown was pretty popular last slate, started, played 33 minutes, had a pretty good game. His price tag's up to 5,400, so if Bruce Brown does start again, he'll be a playable option, but I'm not like running to roster him at 5,400. I think this is kind of the price that he should be at. But he would be definitely be playable if MPJ sits. KCP is also questionable, so like if KCP and MPJ sit, that would obviously be even better for Bruce Brown. Don't know who they would start in place of KCP. I'm guessing it would be like maybe Jeff Green. I guess they could do that. Like they could slide everyone up and then start Jeff Green. I don't know though. We'd have to keep an eye on that Denver starting lineup. But Denver could be without two starters today if MPJ and KCP sit. Yo, Jared Vanderbilt, super frustrating player to roster because he has a ton of upside. I feel like I've played him almost every slate this season. He's a really good point per minute player, but he just always is in foul trouble. If he stays out of foul trouble, he could definitely put up 35, 40 DK points. He can go out there and get you a double-double. He can block shots. He can get defensive stats. He just always is in foul trouble. It's so annoying. He put up 24 DK points in just 18 minutes against Denver last time these teams played, but he fouled out in 18 minutes. He's fouled out now in two out of their five games. He's had at least five fouls in four out of the five games. He's had at least four fouls in all five games this season. The guy just always is in foul trouble, but if he stays out of foul trouble, I think there's definitely upside for Jared Vanderbilt. That's probably it for this one. I don't see too much else I'm liking in this game. Let's go ahead and move on to the last two games of the night, the late night hammers, Pelicans and Suns. So this is one we're going to have to spend some time on. The Pelicans right now could be really depleted. They already have Brandon Ingram ruled out. Zion is questionable. CJ McCollum is questionable as well. So, man, really tough to talk too much about the Pelicans until we get some news on Zion and McCollum. But if Zion sits, I'm guessing you would see most likely Najee Marshall start. We did see last game without Brandon Ingram and without Zion, they started Najee Marshall and they started Trey Murphy. I'm assuming Trey Murphy will start once again in place of Ingram. Marshall would probably start for Zion. And then if CJ McCollum is out, we actually did see them start. We saw them start Jose Alvarado last game with Herb Jones out. Now, Herb Jones is also questionable. So, man, like if Zion, McCollum, and Herb Jones are all out, I have no idea what the Pelicans will do because like Jose Alvarado is questionable too. I would say like, if McCollum sits, then Alvarado is going to be like a great value play, but McCollum's questionable. So just kind of looking at the Pelicans right now, if everyone is playing, if Zion's in, if McCollum's in, if Herb is in, Alvarado, I don't think there's anything I'm loving from the Pelicans. Obviously, Zion, McCollum, JVal would all get a little boost with Ingram out, but none of them would be like priority plays today. where it becomes interesting is if these guys start to get ruled out. Like if McCollum is out, if Zion's out, then you can start to look to guys like, you know, Jose Alvarado if he plays. If Jose Alvarado doesn't play, we can look to Devontae Graham. You know, Herb Jones got priced up a good amount, but if Zion, McCollum, and Herb are all out, I mean, you know, Trey Murphy at 5,600, I think I said Herb Jones, but Trey Murphy at 5,600 actually I think would still be viable if all these guys were out. Like, there's just going to be a good amount of value from the Pelicans depending on who plays. If everyone plays, probably not going to go to much here. If these guys start getting ruled out, though, you're going to want to get some exposure to the Pelicans. This could be where kind of a, you know, all of our value comes from today. Definitely would say that, like, if Zion and McCollum are both out, my favorite plays on the Pelicans are probably Alvarado and Devontae Graham, then probably like Trey Murphy. J-Val, I don't know if J-Val would get like a massive boost. I don't know if his role would really change. He's not a guy that's going to like demand the ball and take a ton of shots, but I definitely think you'd see obviously a ton of opportunity for the guards, for Alvarado, for Graham. Even, you know, this guy, I forgot what his name was. See if I can find him. Let's see. Or this Daniels guy, he's questionable too, but he played really well last game without Brandon Ingram. He might get some minutes. I've never heard of Dyson Daniels, but I know he played really well last game. He might get some minutes, so... yeah, tough situation right now with the Pelicans. Definitely going to have to be something we kind of keep an eye on, you know, heading up to locks. Unfortunately, this is one of the late night games, so like I don't know when we're going to get this news. But on the Phoenix side, you know, there's not much I'm loving on Phoenix today. Devin Booker at 9K, I think is priced appropriately. I think Chris Paul and DeAndre Ayton are probably my two favorite plays from Phoenix. Paul at 7,300 does still feel a little bit too cheap. We know Chris Paul's a guy that can, you know, do everything when he's on the floor, score a rebound, get assists. He can get you a double-double, a points assist double-double. His rebounds have been way up lately, still playing really good minutes. Obviously, this is kind of a rematch of the, you know, the playoffs last season when the Pelicans upset them. So I think Chris Paul here, you know, at 7,300 is firmly in play today. And I think DeAndre Ayton at 7,100 is viable too. Ayton should get pretty good minutes here. Was limited by foul trouble last game, and he's been in foul trouble in like back-to-back games now. But when Ayton's not in foul trouble, he's normally going to play like high 30s minutes. 7,100, I still think Ayton is probably a little bit too cheap. So definitely my favorite plays on Phoenix are Chris Paul and DeAndre Ayton. Probably not going to anyone else on the Suns, though. Obviously, interest in the Pelicans is going to depend on who's actually playing for them. We'll have to, you know, kind of wait and see there. But talking about the last game of the night, the Blazers and the Rockets. So this is another one we're going to have to spend some time on. Damian Lillard already been ruled out for the Blazers. I think he's going to be out for like 1 to 2 weeks. So without Damian Lillard, there's going to be a lot of usage available. Yusuf Nurkic, Anthony Simons, Josh Hart, Jeremy Grant, I think all get a little boost. Anthony Simons made him the cover boy for today. I mean, love Anthony Simons here. I think it's a fantastic matchup for him against Houston. We've seen guards be able to kill Houston this year. John Morant had a huge game against them. I know Jordan Clarkson did really well against Houston pretty recently. I think it's a fantastic matchup for Anthony Simons. And we know Simons is one of these guys that can produce at a really high rate when given opportunity. When he's the guy getting all the usage, he can put up massive games. And obviously without Damian Lillard, Anthony Simons is going to be one of the go-to guys on offense. Should play big minutes here. Even though his price tag did come up to 7,100, you could argue that Simons should be like 8K today. So I still think Anthony Simons is a really strong play. I think Nurkic and, you know, Josh Hart are solid as well. I mean, Josh Hart did get priced up, but I think Josh Hart's going to have more opportunity here. We know Josh Hart's a guy that can do everything when he's on the floor, score, rebound, and get assist. And obviously, Nurkic has massive upside every time he steps on the court. It's just a matter of if he can get the minutes, if he can stay out of foul trouble. In a good matchup against Houston, I think this is definitely a spot where Nurkic could have a big game. At 7,200, I do have some interest in Nurkic as well. And then Jeremy Grant, I don't mind either, but he's probably like my fourth favorite guy on Portland today. I don't know who they're going to start in place of Dame. We know Nurkic, Simons, Hart, and Grant are going to start. They could go with Shaedon Sharpe, and if Shaedon Sharpe does start alongside Simons, he'd be definitely a playable value. He's 4,400. You know, so far this season and the minutes he's gotten, he's been about a fantasy point per minute player. So I definitely would like Shaedon Sharpe today for value if he does wind up starting. Obviously, really good matchup against Houston. And then on the other side with Houston, not a ton I'm loving from Houston today. Kevin Porter Jr. at 7,600 feels priced about right. He's probable, so he's expected to play today. We know Kevin Porter Jr. has massive upside. We know he's going to have a big role with the Rockets, play big minutes, but the $7,600 salary doesn't make him stand out to me. Same with Jalen Green at 6,700. Jabari Smith at 6,600 doesn't really stand out either. Alperen Şengün is questionable, and if he winds up, or he's actually probable, so he's expected back for this game. So that probably just, that would take me off of Jabari Smith with Şengün expected back. And then, you know, like KJ Martin, Eric Gordon, Jay Shante, none of these guys really look that appealing. Pretty much all my interest in this game is coming on the Portland side. Obviously, Portland, without Damian Lillard, is going to be a team we kind of want to get some exposure to today, especially because some of these price tags, I think, you could argue are still a little bit, you know, too cheap. But that's it for this 11-game slate for Friday night, guys. I hope you enjoyed this video. I hope it did help. Hit that like button if you guys enjoyed. Hit that subscribe button if you have not yet. And again, check out the sponsor of the video, Prize Picks. Go sign up for Prize Picks. Use promo code NOAH. When you do, get your first deposit match up to $100. I will be sharing a couple plays I like for Prize Picks today. Probably will upload that video sometime kind of early Friday morning. Check the channel out then. Hopefully, you know, my Prize Picks video will be up early for you guys. Give you some plays I like for today. But as always, guys, thanks for watching the videos. Appreciate your support. Hope you guys enjoyed. We'll see you in the next one.